So,
awesome.
I guess we're going to get started. Jethro's going to talk about awesome automated RADIUS stuff.
Cool. Just then, so like I was saying, Bishop Wellingtonian, done a lot of Linux for the last 5 or so years professionally. And in the last couple of years, I'm doing a lot of work with central authentication solutions for customers. We're talking people like telcos, companies with hundreds of servers, that sort of environment. And over that time, I've done a bit of work in terms of both just trying to figure out how the ship works and also building tools to make the management of LDAP and RADIUS environments a lot easier. So tonight, I'm going to give you a bit of an overview of how LDAP and how RADIUS work, the high-level concepts, explain a bit about how the underlying structure works, and then show you actually how to practically build a server and save yourself a whole bunch of pain. If you've got any questions anyway through, just give me a yell and I can stop and go over it or refer to it later on. And if I'm going too fast or you're not a bit sure about something, just give me a yell and I'll slow down and cover it off. Awesome. So, what is centralised authentication? Effectively, it's a system where you can store users, groups, and sometimes other information in a central location and access it across multiple systems. So typically it's as basic as your user database and a group database somewhere which you can refer to for your systems, but it can also be as complex as things like RADIUS attributes where you push out additional values to devices, Active Directory where you push out permissions to Windows users. So it can encompass a whole lot more than just simple logons and details. It can also include access controls, permissions, attributes, and other bits of information. Typically, with a central authentication system, it will support multiple platforms. Most systems which aren't Microsoft will support pretty much any Unix operating system off the shelf, as well as multiple development platforms. Effectively, it's just one place to manage your user information. So you've got one system to go to manage your users, groups, and the other details you wish. So some particular examples you'll be probably familiar or at least heard of, obviously LDAP, Kerberos, if anyone's ever come across that, and of course Microsoft's much beloved Active Directory. So everyone loves diagrams, right. And also everyone loves Visio. So here's a nice Visio diagram of a bunch of boxes talking to a central authentication service. So typically you'll have a pair of boxes, regardless of what your technology you're running. Central authentication is really, really vital, because if it goes down and you're relying on it, you'll find a whole bunch of stuff breaks really, really easily. And I'll cover a bit more about that a bit later on. So, what's LDAP? It's effectively a directory book, think like a phone book, which you can access across your network. So yeah, sorry, I made my size in a hurry, so I'm not quite sure what comes next sometimes. So, we tend to think of LDAP, people say, oh, we should set LDAP authentication for our users, and you go, oh, LDAP, okay, I guess it's like a user system, you chuck users in it, and away it works. It's much more of a database than it is a solution or a program. So, in the same respects that MySQL is not a user database, LDAP is not a user database. They can both store users, store groups, but they can store a whole bunch more than just that. They're very flexible and can be used for different purposes.
Technically, the name of the protocol.
Yeah.
There's multiple servers that implement it.
Yeah, so LDAP is the protocol itself, and it's a standardized protocol, but there's multiple servers that will implement it. Open LDAP, Red Hat Directory Server, and a whole bunch of other ones. And I'll show you a couple of the popular ones later on. So basically, it's not a relational database. If you've ever done any development work or anything with MySQL programs, that's what you tend to think of when you think of a user database, where you've got your standard columns and then your rows of content inside that. LDAP is very, very different. It's much more of a tree-based structure. We have different entities, different levels of that. So typically you'll have your organization. As a note, I'm using example.com here, but you can actually call it anything. It could be DC equals Snapples, and it'll be fine. But as a default way, we tend to always do it based on the organization's domain name, because you know it's going to be unique, and it makes sense, it's easy to refer to. So under that, you'll have groups, people, groups, You might also have some other ones like attributes or access control lists or other details, and then your records inside that. So LDAP is designed for, well, it's originally designed as part of X500, which is a specification they developed back in the 70s, I believe. And it's designed very much around a telco-focused directory structure where you have phones, regions, and that sort of architectural tree-based level. So it's quite weird when you first start looking at it, because you think, oh, why don't they just use, you know, a relational table like a MySQL or Postgres? It's easy, everyone understands that. But the heritage of it is a lot older, and it makes sense once you get into it and have a look through it. There's a whole bunch more to that standard, X500, but all we care about is the fact that it's the forefather of LDAP. Feel free to look it up if you're really bored. So that's what an LDAP database looks a bit more like. So instead of, like I was saying before, instead of a traditional columns and rows structure, you instead have a record which is defined by its DN, distinguished name. So up the top there, we've got distinguished name, UID, user test 1, OU people, OU auth, DC examples, DC AmbDMS, DC com. AmbDMS is my old company, so I've got a few references to that. So that's quite a flexible structure because I can define multiple groups under there. I could say OU equals auth, or I could say OU equals address book. You have multiple different groups of structure under your tree. Then based on that DN, I've got my actual record with its attributes and its values. So user ID of user test 1, UID number is 1056. So it's basically just matching those. And then you've got your object class, which is basically saying inherit the structure defined by this class. So I'm inheriting the init org person structure, and that defines what attributes I have to set and what attributes are optional. So without getting into too much detail, effectively the object classes define what structure your records should behave or adhere to. I'm using a whole bunch of examples up there which are common for user authentication, but you could easily have, say, just an org person if you're doing an address book, or something else entirely, depending on what you're trying to do with it. I've got, at the moment, an org person which defines the basic attributes like surname, given name, optionally email address, and a few other details. POSIX account, shadow account, they define some of the key values I need to set the user's logon details. And then I've got some RADIUS specific ones, RADIUS profile and RADIUS microtick, which is RADIUS profile is generic RADIUS attributes, and microtick is vendor specific to microtick devices. So you can extend it all. I mean, I can remove some of those, add additional ones, depending on what I'm trying to do at the time.
So that user applies to that object class, right? Yeah. You have multiple services running against.
Yeah, I'll just show you an object class if I have one lying around. Hang on. I love the plural and non-plural behaviour of React packages. You're never quite sure which is which. Is it server or is it servers? So, OpenLDAP has a whole bunch of schema files which define these structures. Person. So, in here we're defining the structure of an org group. So, for example, display name, department name, a whole bunch of other stuff. Let's find something useful.
So those are the keys in your LDAP.
Yeah, in this group. So here we are. So in the org person, this bit here, this is the object class that I'm inheriting for my person. And it says this user may have the following attributes. They may have their audio, their display name, their employee number, their mail address, their room number. So those are all optional attributes that a user who has an org person can have. Other ones might have mandatory requirements. Like you say, it might say, for example, you must have a display name, or you must have an email address. If I look at an example, what have we got?
And then those attributes themselves are defined.
Correct,
whether they're a string or whether they're a number.
Yeah, so it defines what it is. And you can define
arbitrary, you can arbitrary define object classes.
Yeah, so here's a good example. POSIX accounts. This is one of the main ones I'm using for authentication. It defines that you must have common name, UID, UID number, GID, and home directory, and you may optionally set a password, login shell, description, and fuck knows what GECOS is. So it's flexible in that you can define your structure and then your objects have to adhere to that. But you can define your own. I mean, I've defined the previous example, which is RADIUS MicroTick, for a box that one of my vendors or one of my customers is using a lot of, with additional fields and so forth. So you can define your own structures, but there's a whole bunch of predefined, and I'm not sure if it's, I think they're standardized structures like init org person. So you might look, if you're doing a project with LDAP, you might look at the documentation for your program if you want to use with LDAP, and it'll say, uses the following schema, init org person, POSIX account, and you'll be like, okay, cool, I've got both of those, or, oh, I don't have that one, I better add it to all my users so they get those attributes it needs.
A trap for some younger players with this is that these schemas can have the same name and slightly different versions of them, depending on the vendor.
The other great one is sometimes you have a field which is standardized, like, say, postal address, which is a text field. But different programs will treat it in different ways. And one of the ones that really used to screw you over was Thunderbird's LDAP and Evolution's LDAP stored addresses in different formats. So depending on which program you're using, your address information wouldn't be usable on the other program. So it's a central database, but it's not necessarily, not everyone's running to the same standards. It's a little bit vendor dependent. Cool. So we don't have to do heaps with LDAP from the back end. I mean, you can do all the stuff manually from the command line. You can enter records, modify records, all manually from the CLI. In reality, unless you've got more time on your hands than you like or you're crazy, you're not going to do it. It's too hard to deal with. Typically, you'll define your structures, you'll import your initial seed users, you know, a basic setup account and whatnot, and then you'll manage it with a tool to make your life a lot easier. So, scalability. How well does this work? Well, personally, I've done anything from 1 user to 18,000 users on my setups, but OpenLDAP and many of other databases will do millions of users. It scales really well, and also it actually scales with minimal engineering effort. You can pretty much fire up OpenLDAP, run with all the defaults, chuck 18,000 users in, and it will just go. There's very little tweaking you have to do, whereas if you ever maybe chucked 18,000 or a million records in, say, a SQL database, it's usually a little bit more thought you have to put into it to make it actually run in a reasonable fashion. And as I was saying, it runs on heaps of stuff. I mean, Linux supports it natively, Solaris supports it natively, Windows can kind of support it. It's Windows, it's special. A lot of applications will work with it, so if you ever bought a vendor application, so, you know, you plonk down $1 million, you buy your telco management software or whatever, you'll typically find it will support LDAP for auth user authentication. You can make pretty much any web app work with it because Apache, And probably the other ones like NGIX will support LDAP as an authentication method. If not, the program itself often does as well. VoIP phones, they're not so much for authentication, but for address books. So, you know, you have your VoIP phone display hooked into the company LDAP address book and you can see records on it. Really quite a handy feature. Routers, you know, you log into your Juniper router or whatever, you can use LDAP in the back end. And also, all popular programming languages have frameworks in place to manage LDAP records. PHP does, Perl does, Python does, even .NET does, and I imagine pretty much any programming language that's been around for a while will have an LDAP module somewhere to deal with it for you.
Talking just on your LDAP, I also found it that Active Directory itself
is quite ADE-like. Active Directory is an interesting one because it uses two standards, LDAP and Kubernetes, but use them in different ways to everyone else. I think it's got some vendor-specific extensions. So you can't just replace the Active Directory server with an LDAP or Kubernetes server for the same record structure. There's a bit more to it, which is typical Microsoft. Take something and tweak it in a way which doesn't work for everyone else. So
depends
it does...
Depends what you're trying to replace.
Depends what you're trying to replace. You can't just replace...
What I'm pointing out is you can point things like your VoIP phones at AD.
Yeah.
And they'll talk over LDAP protocol.
Isn't AD a subset of LDAP? I mean,
it's LDAP with extensions.
Yeah.
And Kerberos.
LDAP, Kerberos, and a whole bunch of proprietary glue.
Yeah, but I mean, it's got its pedigree from back in the LDAP, early LDAP development.
Yeah, I'm assuming that. Well, I mean, LDAP's been around, for years. Quite so they pulled my ideas and design behind that. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's actually quite a good way of doing stuff, but then they've extended it with all the additional bits on top of that.
And an example being, you know, LDAP module in Linux,
yep.
Can be pointed at AD.
Yeah.
against AD.
The downside is you can do Linux against AD, but you can't do Windows directly against OpenLDAP or Kerberos for Linux. You have to put something like Samba in between it to treat your Windows host properly. And I will go over that briefly in here, actually, a little bit about that. There's a whole bunch of tricks around that as well. So, in terms of the open source space, OpenLDAP's one of the most, well, I think it is literally the most popular LDAP server around. It's been around for years, it's in all major distributions. It ships as part of Red Hat, ships as part of Debian. If you don't have it, then your distribution is broken. It's going to be in there. There's a couple others around. The other one worth mentioning is 389 Directory Server, also known as Red Hat Directory Server, also known as Fedora Directory Server, and once upon a time known as Netscape Directory Server. Short story is Red Hat brought
up.
Oh, didn't know about that one. Even better.
Same one.
Yeah, Red Hat brought it and then developed it further and kept renaming it for a while. But they settled on 389 for now, so we'll see what happens.
So that army knows the same.
So it's interesting. OpenLDAP's very much a traditional Unix style application. That's one thing that does it well. I'm an LDAP server, fuck off, let me do my job. And you use other tools to manage it graphically and things like that. 389 Directory Server is very much a enterprise Java background where you have a graphical interface and you log on, you can point and click users and objects and move things around little windows. So they're very different approaches to solving the same problem. They've both got their merits. I mean, 389 Directory Server is nice from the point of view of I'm an LDAP noob, I want to log on and create some records. It's still very complex, but it allows you to do stuff and figure out what's going on relatively straightforward. It's GUI, you can work out what you're doing. Whereas OpenLDAP is, okay, I've got my server running, but now what do I do? It's a bit more manual.
Point out it also has someone that has some additional features that it doesn't necessarily have, but they're advanced things.
Yeah, I mean, when I looked at 389, because I did some Red Hat training on their LDAP server, and then when I compared it to OpenLDAP, I was like, knowing the concepts, I'd much rather use OpenLDAP. Supports replication, master-master, anything like that. It pretty much does everything I needed to do. There's very little reason for me personally to go and grab Red Hat's product. Having said that, there's probably someone somewhere who goes, oh no, but it's got this great feature, which is amazing, and changes things.
Do you know much about the Apache directory?
No, not familiar with that one. But like Lynn says, there's got to be a whole bunch of different servers around. The concepts apply across all of them, and if you're using something like OpenLDAP or 389 Directory Server, you fire your LDAP syntax in it, it's just going to work on either of them. It's only if you start doing fancier stuff where you might find that one doesn't have the same schema as the other. And not LDAP, but related to what I'm talking about is FreeRadius, which actually is the most widely deployed RADIUS server in the world. And it's actually a foundation for a lot of commercial RADIUS products as well. And I'll come back to RADIUS in a little bit and just detail what that is in relation to LDAP. So, well, actually I'll come back to it right now. So if LDAP's so awesome, why do we need RADIUS? I mean, we've already covered the fact that pretty much everything under the sun can authenticate against LDAP. Well, RADIUS adds a little bit more. RADIUS is very much focused for routers and other network devices. So, Most modern routers off the shelf will support both LDAP and RADIUS. You can grab your Juniper box, your Cisco box, you can point it at either information for authentication. However, RADIUS adds attributes and accounting. So, attributes are when I log into my router, it goes to RADIUS. RADIUS sends back, oh yeah, user Jethro is okay to allow, but also here's his Cisco authentication level, and here's his Juniper authentication level, and here's his IP address that he should be using. So it hands back a lot more information in a standard way. It also does accounting, which is really handy for an ISP because your user plugs in their DSL modem. The DSL modem authenticates using RADIUS over PPPoA to the ISP. ISP goes, okay, user Jethro logged on, and here's all the details, given all the settings, and now that he's running, send me a packet every 5 minutes telling me how much data he's used. So every 5 minutes, the router sends a RADIUS accounting packet saying, Jethro's used 10 gig, 50 gig, 100 gig, and then from that, your ISP can write systems that will then lock the user off or bill them accordingly. So in all the deployments I've done of LDAP, we tend to always do a RADIUS deployment along with it, because the customer has routers and stuff they want to have additional information for, or they want to bill accounting data for. And the cool thing is they work together really nicely. You can have free RADIUS talking to open LDAP. So the LDAP is your one place for all your user details, but you can authenticate with those user details either with LDAP directly or via RADIUS. And of course, if your network's got Windows boxes, you can add Samba into the mix as well, which is how you then get your Windows boxes to log on against an LDAP server. You just need a little Samba glue in the middle to make it work. So, one of the problems, of course, of, like I was saying before, of LDAP is, if you've just got a stock build, doing user management from the CLI is a little bit ugly. So just before I came out, I was, you know, oh yeah, I'll create a new group, I'll dump all my group attributes or structure to a file, and then I'll import it. Oh wait, I'm a fucking idiot, I've got the wrong structure for that, correct it. Oh no, that's not right, do it again. So it's not something you're going to want to do in a production environment because it's too freaking hard. You know, if I'm an LDAP guru and I sit around and make these mistakes because they're paying me off to do stuff from the command line, your level one support guys are going to have a real fucking nightmare trying to do it, deal with it. So what we do then to solve that is create or use graphical tools. So this is a little bit of self-promotion, but it's a tool I wrote a while back, which is pretty much just focuses on user and group management for an LDAP directory in the back end. There's plenty of other tools around. I know that a few distributions like to ship their own little packages. I'm sure Glenn will jump up and tell you that Mandriva has a nice little graphical interface for managing users and groups. There's a popular program called PHP LDAP Admin. It's basically like the equivalent of PHP MyAdmin for LDAP, so you can log on, add attributes, structures, and so forth, and define it. One of the weaknesses, though, is you've got two types of graphical interfaces. One is we've designed it for a particular task, so this is a graphical interface to manage address box, or this is a graphical interface to manage user authentication, or it's on the other extreme, which is like PHP LDAP Admin, here's a graphical interface to manage every possible record in LDAP. So you either have very simplified interfaces or overly complex and too widely configurable interfaces. In the case of deployments I've always done, typically a customer goes, I want it to be foolproof, I just want to manage users. So in my case I built this open source tool which manages users and groups, but there's certainly some other ones available. I mean, once you set up LDAP, do a bit of research, find a tool that you like or that's supported by your vendors and run with it. There's a lot of open source tools, proprietary tools, web-based, desktop-based, whatever suits. So that one, LDAP Auth Manager is fully open source. You can grab it off the above link, and I'll do a demo with it later today because it makes life a lot easier when you're managing and creating users and so forth.
How do you like Webman for LDAP Admin?
Kinda. A little bit different. I'll do a demo later on.
One of the difficulties that you have with the wallet, simplify use is getting them, if you've got a structure that's not stock standard, getting them to do something slightly different. You get them to add one extra attribute, or take one away, or
yeah.
That's where they go.
So I mean, for that, something like your generic tool, like maybe PHP older admin's going to do a nice job because it supports the whole structure overall, but then you said your level one guys doesn't support everything?
Then it's not simple.
Yeah. Well, it's not simple, no. But supports all the attributes overall. But it's complex. You're not going to say to your level one guy, oh, can you add me to the bot? He's going to look at it and go, where the fuck do I do that? Or what do I do here? Or what's going on? It's too complex. We'll just pick up and run with. Something like this, you can just pick up and run with. But obviously, if you've bought an off-the-shelf proprietary product and you need to add a certain customization, you're not going to be able to do that. Something like this, hopefully you can just jump in and hack it reasonably easily if you have to do that unique attributes. I mean, to be honest, you're only going to be dealing with unique attributes if you're doing something particularly tricky or you may be a very large enterprise with a whole bunch of specific applications or devices that have to have a certain structure. If you're just a small deployment, you know, maybe 30 servers or internal company network only, you can pretty much just define it how you want to do it, so something like this will probably work quite nicely. So, in production, what does it actually look like? So, typically we'll have two servers running, a primary and secondary. Basically what happens is whenever you do an authentication request, it has to go to one of the servers, get resolved and send back the answer, user's permission or not or not. However, what gets interesting is you actually don't realize normally how much Linux has to do that in the background. For example, if I want to list a directory, ls, it doesn't just list the directory, it also has to go to a user database and look up what all the usernames are for those ID numbers. So if your LDAP server is down, when you do an ls, you'll sit there for a long time waiting for RLS to contact the directory server and resolve all the usernames of all the files in the directory. So there's actually a lot that goes on in the background once you deploy something like LDAP, and it's vital that you have a redundancy so that if the primary does go down, you can still list files, log on, and not have programs basically pause on you. And I'll give you a little demo later on, because it's quite a nasty gotcha that can get you sunk if you're not used to it. It's kind of like if you lose DNS resolving on your network, and a whole bunch of programs will just hang for ages trying to resolve DNS, and trying to figure out why things aren't working or why things are so slow, because programs are sitting there waiting for 10 seconds or whatever for DNS to time out. Exact same thing with LDAP. It's not fun. And we've had that a couple of times. We've had networks would have lost access to the LDAP server entirely. And of course your admins are like, oh, we'll be able to log on to see what's going on. And you're trying to log on, of course you can't, because there's no LDAP there. So you sit there for ages waiting for it to time out. Trying to trace directories on the server, do a listing, again get stuck waiting for the list because of the timeouts. So we always do redundancy for that.
Can we talk recovery just now?
Yep, I'll cover that at the end. So we have, you know, we have your client set up to resolve against either host, and along with that you have your free radio set up, and potentially your SAMBA set up as well, or whatever other tools that you have hooking into LDAP, and some form of management tool, whether it's LDAP Wolf Manager, which is what I've got, or something else that's shipped by a vendor. So, demo time. Demo's much funner.
Any comments about running that on one would assume two physically separate servers, physical servers, but any comments about running LDAP authentication servers on a VM?
Oh, that's fine. I mean, everything I do, both myself and also for customers these days, tend to be virtualized. We have very few customers ever using dedicated physical hardware. Just, of course, make sure you don't put both your primary and your secondary on the same physical host. If you lose that host, you're going to lose both VMs, which isn't exactly useful. My recommendation for my customers is always, if you've got one site, obviously primary and secondary on different VMs. If you've got two sites, put one VM at each site. That's pretty much the best you can do.
Obviously, your host would be authenticated against some LDAP database as well. So, you would need two hosts with the LDAP VM, LDAP, and then pointing to each other's for authentication.
No, the hosts themselves can point to the local LDAP store. So, if you're an LDAP server, you can look up from yourself locally.
But your VMs are going to be up when you boot up.
So the actual host stuff. Okay, what in that case is, We tend to adjust the timeouts on the host for LDAP lookups. So if a host tries to boot, so let's say you've got a network that's been completely powered off. You're booting up your VM server. VM server tries to boot. Okay, I need to look up user sysadmin. LDAP's not available. By default, we'll sit there trying to time out for maybe 15 seconds. Reconfigure our host to time out within 1 second. So, 1 second, can't resolve LDAP, keep booting up. The server still boot and still run.
Okay.
It just can't look up non-privileged users. What then happens is, of course, though, server boots, VM start up, it starts the LDAP VM, and then everything starts really nicely. There's some other tricks you can do as well, like have certain users defined locally versus LDAP. And I mean, but default LDAP setup will still have a certain number of users locally, like all your standard, pretty much all those users will still be defined locally, all your system users and program install users. If you install an RPM or a dev package as a user account, it'll be added locally. You won't do it for your entire network, unless you really wanted to for some reason. It's pretty much only your defined users who'll be across all of them.
Sweet.
Cool. So I'll do a quick run through of a setup. So this is a stock standard RHEL 5 box. So it's a little bit outdated, but pretty much the exact same as RHEL 6. Most of these concepts will apply to other distributions. There's a couple of differences around the client config, and I will show you that. They're good.
Have you played RHEL 6 recently? I would suggest it's not the same.
From the LDAP point of view,
RHEL 6 no longer has schemas and files inside LDAP.
Oh, you're talking about structure? No, yes and no. That's an
LDAP.
Yeah, it's an LDAP server change. From a client side, it's the same. Yeah. From LDAP server change, by default it's inside the directory, inside the server, but I tend to pull it out and run it as local files for what I'm tend to be doing. It's a lot easier to manage. But you can actually do the same, because you can get, a quick look.
I just just that I mentioned that it's
That's a fair point.
The
RHEL 5 actually has, RHEL 5 ships open LDAP 2.3, but there is a sort of 2.4 package available. There's a couple changes, like the directory, like the configuration inside the directory itself. But for my case, I struck back to the local files, which is a is an acceptable way of operating it. They haven't deprecated that yet. Cool, so we reinstalled our servers just before. So if we go to Open LDAP. So yeah, what my demo's giving me with Open LDAP. If you want to talk to me about Red Hat Directory Server, I can talk about it, but Open LDAP's cooler. So let's roll off that. Cool. So we've got two main config files. One is LDAP.conf. That defines your default settings for your client tools. So that's tools that look up your LDAP database. So you can do, for example, queries or searches against any host you wanted to, but by default it will use these particular ones. And SLAPD defines your actual server structure. So it's pretty minimal in terms of what's actually defined in here. You can print it from the default. So at the top here, that includes are defining what schemas you're going to import. So the default ones do for well user authentication, but you could add additional schemas like include vendor.schema or some other weird variations that you needed.
So the just to expand on that, the object classes that you define for your attribute have to be defined in your schemas. If you haven't included the schema, you can't use that object.
Correct. So if you try to import LDAP data that doesn't have a schema defined for it, it's going to complain and not necessarily in a very useful verbose way. It's just going to say it doesn't accept it, or structure's not available, or some other not particularly helpful message. How much of modules? You can actually do a lot with LDAP in regards to policies and access control and so forth. A lot of these I don't tend to have touched in the past, but have a look if something you need, feel free to use it.
I've used the SMB5 password module.
Oh, yeah?
Quite useful.
What does that one do?
What it does is if you're storing Samba passwords in your directory as well as Unix passwords, when you set your password, making it a proper password call using the LDAP protocol, it calculates the Samba password and updates
it. Oh, that's the thing. Yeah, Samba's one of those really annoying things where in most cases all your LDAP clients can authenticate against your standard user password attribute. Samba and a few other systems have to have their own password structure, which is like in NT format. So you tend to define two password attributes and make sure you keep them both up to date. So this module is probably worth checking out to have a help for that.
I think Webin includes that as well.
Sure.
Sync up all your passwords across the board.
Yeah. TLS encryption, so you tend to want to encrypt your data going between your boxes. That's pretty straightforward to set up. I'm not going to cover it tonight because it's not really relevant to LDAP itself. It's a standard configuration. If you haven't done much with SSL CAs before, you have to do a bit of research on it. Basically, with LDAP, you've got to set up, rather than just doing it, start from scratch. If you're an engineer and you go, oh yeah, I want to run a website, it's got to be SSL, and I can't be bothered buying a cert, I'll just self-sign a cert, away you go. It's quite easy. There's a lot of docs on the web on how to do that one. With LDAP, you can't just self-sign a cert and shove it in. You have to create a certificate authority and then sign your server keys against that CA. And the reason for that is you can then give your keys to your servers and then revoke them based on CA, and your clients can verify your servers are trusted using the CA key. It's the exact same model that works in a browser, but if you haven't done it before, it adds a bit more learning curve to LDAP because you've got to learn how to actually make certs and sign them. Again, there's tons of docs on my web, but I've got some links I'll send down the list on how to do that. I won't cover it tonight.
I would suggest that just turning it off is a bad idea if you care about security.
Yeah, I mean, it depends also what you're storing in LDAP. I mean, by default, your passwords are hashed. So user will see everything that's in etc password or etc shadow. So they can get your hashes of your passwords to try and brute force them. But if you're doing things right, you won't see plain text passwords, for example. But you're definitely exposing a bit more information than you're going to want to expose normally. Especially if you're going to a public link. Access control, you can define who can actually make changes to the database. So we tend to say, on a trusted network, you might say everyone can read the database, but only a few people can actually make changes to it, or only the actual users can change their own details. If you're running on an untrusted link or an untrusted host in your network, you're pretty much going to make it authentication required in order to query the database. So two types of authentication. There's the authentication is actually using information in the database to perform its own authentication versus your servers authenticating with LDAP itself to be given access to the database. They can use the same information inside the database, but in different processes. Hopefully that makes a little bit of sense. Basically, you've got to authenticate with LDAP before you can process authentication using LDAP. I'll show you a little bit of a demo later on, it'll make a little bit more sense. And then you're basically defining your structure. So your suffix is your base, your root of your directory structure. So I pretty much always use the domain name for the company I'm working with, example.com, for example, DC equals example, DC equals com. And then your root DN is basically the root user of LDAP. This user can do everything, change everything on their system. And the DN defines what the username is going to be. So instead of just logging on as manager or Bob, you log on against that whole DN tree. And you've got to define what the credentials are in here in an encrypted format. Directory database must exist. That's all done for you. You can pretty much just start open LDAP once you've made a couple basic settings and it will all run. And it also defines here what indexes to maintain. Again, for pretty much everyone, the standards are fine. And as well as other features like replication and so forth. So, I had some notes on what I was going to do. Set up in our dab, you stop talking. Sweet. Cool.
That's a good one.
Right, well, I'm going to go grab that one. So I've installed OpenLDAP, I want to set up the LDAP configuration. So I've got a couple sample files here, I'm going to save a bit of time. We'll steal from these files. So this is some sample files I shipped with some of my open source projects to make setup a bit easier. The key parts you're going to want to change initially is your security policy section, defining who can do what, and your LDAP database itself, the settings in that. So, well, first of all, we're going to need a root password for the LDAP database. Password. New password will be password. That's really bad. Cool. So what's done here is I defined a hashed password. That's going to be the root logon for the server. And when I edit the entry, I can now set it here. So root PW is going to be that one. That's not very secure password, don't ever do that. So again, for your DC, example, DC equals com, you can't do things like DCExample.com. Well, you can probably do it, but I think the dot will break it. I've just looked it up in a while since I did that.
Unicode supported?
Good question.
If you want .co.nz, put comma DC.
Yeah, so you know, DC equals co, DC equals NZ. That's pretty much how we structure it. Replace, basically replacing your dot with DC equals whatever.
DC stands for domain component.
Cool.
CNS?
Common name.
Yep, it's common name. You've also got UID and... what's the other one? There's another form you can have as well.
Group ID probably as well.
DN is distinguished.
So you can also have OU, Operational Unit, I think it is.
Yeah. Organization Unit.
Organization Unit, yeah. So in some larger environments where I might have, say, multiple trees of LDAP, I might have one tree for address box and one tree for authentication. I might do it like OU equals auth, DC equals example, DC equals com, and OU equals addresses, DC example, DC com, to split them out for two different data types. It's very much like saying, Here's database 1, database 2, and inside that I've got tables for users and tables for addresses. It's just a different way of looking at it.
Can nodes belong to multiple trees?
No, your tree is your tree and that's it.
So it's just a trainer.
Yeah, which is a little bit annoying because sometimes you do, oh, well actually I want to have all my users automatically be in my address book. But if your address book data is a different structure, you can't just bring that across. You have to define a different structure for that and enter all those records in there. Again, depending on what programs you're using, you might be able to use the same data, you might not be able to. Depends what you're trying to do.
So you don't get something like aliasing, that you can actually just do like soft links?
No, I don't believe so. You might, there might be some modules, but the stock, you can. The module, or is that reference? Cool. There is a feature.
So that would be a way of belonging to multiple structures at the same time.
Yeah, if you need to belong to structures.
Yeah.
I mean, because often you don't. Often you're just searching.
Because I mean, your user might be an admin and a user.
I tend to deal with that in a different way by defining groups for that. So the user belongs to a group admin, because you can do restrictions. So you can say, okay, these servers are high security boxes, we should lock access down. You can say, okay, only allow logons to people who are in the admins group.
Yeah.
Or this other server, it's a mail server, everyone has to have an account on it, allow access to the users group, and then everyone gets permission. So you can define permissions based on the data that's defined in LDAP. So that is interesting. I'll show you some examples, but you can define it. You can use POSIX groups for a lot of programs,
okay.
But some other programs don't support POSIX groups, so you've got to use LDAP groups. Depends what systems you're talking to. Okay, so we define that basic stuff.
Case sensitive?
I believe so, yeah. Good question. I always just remember the case, but I think that's case sensitive.
There's a username problem.
I'm not sure. We'll have a play later on, too, Adams. And of course, security, what's the basic security in place? So I think we have default structures, you know, in this case, I'm allowing read all to all users write by self write. So if we uncomment that. So anonymous users, so a server with no credentials set on it, can authenticate a user against a server. So if I'm, you know, random, I find a random VM, got no config on it, I can still talk to LDAP, and if I give them the password for Jethro, it can say, yes, that is a valid password for Jethro. But I won't expose the password. It allows you to do authentication requests and get confirmation and query information, but not change it and not authenticate against someone. Sorry, not pull their password out. Users can read, and the self basically means if they've authenticated as that user, so Jethro's authenticated, Jethro can write changes to Jethro. I mean, basic stuff that makes sense. In a enterprise deployment, I'll lock it down a bit further, so I'll require servers to authenticate, and I might have something like this here, where I'm basically saying the user client root can authenticate, can write changes, and other options based on that. So you can say, you can lock by removing the anonymous read and write here, you can have it, anonymous read and authentication, you can have it so servers must authenticate as that client root or some other username in order to be able to actually access LDAP altogether. So just to keep it real simple, we're just going to allow basics, write your own user, read data, and authenticate anonymously. We define a suffix, DC example, DC equals com, and we define the root user effectively, which is DC CN manager, DC example, DC com, and you know, we've already got a password defined and stored in a hashed format. So even if someone gets access to the server, they can't see what the actual password is. Let's save that. I love this one on Red Hat boxes. The server is actually called Slab, but you're starting LDAP. It's a bit fucking annoying. Okay, start that up.
That's my idea as well. Good.
Oh.
What was
that? The other one I was showing earlier, Glenn, is open LDAP-servers, plural. So I'm only running one LDAP server. Why is it servers?
Yeah.
Ugh. You can run more than one.
You can run more than one, but you know, you can run Apaches.
You're starting the service with the config. Now, if you make changes to the config and want to reload the config while people are connected to it.
You can do reload or restart. No, you have to do restart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that
tends to be, you don't usually have to change the config that much once it's up and running. Like any records you do all in real time. It's only if you decide, okay, I want to add a new module, add a new schema, you have to add it on and restart
it. This is why you use the 2.4 version, because inside LDAP,
yeah, it's quite an advantage.
You can also define, you know, in AD, you have the domain, then you create the subdomain. Is it also possible with
I'm not that familiar with AD, but I expect it's probably very much like a operational unit segregation. So you have like subdomains with different groups of users.
The subdomains, they have different groups of
users. Yep, you can do the exact same thing with LDAP, but defining different DC or different OU groups. So it might be OU, internal DeFi example, DeFi com, and OU external DeFi example, DeFi com. You've got internal users and external customers, for example. So you can find a very similar thing. Yep, so SAPD is running. So var lib slap LDAP. So this LDAP database, you don't have to do much with it, sitting there running.
It would have just created it as well.
It creates them automatically, yeah. So if you fuck up your system altogether and it's Red Hat, delete the directory, run the boot script, and it starts it and recreates it for you. On rel boxes, at least, you don't get any log, a separate log file for it. It just dumps anything into the syslog if it's configured to do. In fact, actually, on rel, by default, it doesn't dump the logs anywhere, I think. So LDAP can push a whole bunch of logging information out, but you've got to capture it in syslog if you want to do something useful with it. For whatever reason, by default, they don't do it. On rel boxes anyway, I don't know about Debian and elsewise. Cool.
It can be pretty verbose if you turn it up.
Yeah, actually I really dislike the open LDAP logging. It's got two modes, which is silent and everything you don't want to know. It's very hard to get
it
stuff in between.
It does have other modes.
It does, but you put
you
in certain modes.
You just have to know how to hash numbers together and join
yeah,
them.
And you tend to still get things that you don't necessarily want and things you do want. It's not ideal. It's fine when you're debugging. You just turn on the max sort of things and away you go, but for practice it's a bit annoying. Yeah. Cool. I think that's actually probably one of the major complaints with LDAP or LDAP in general. Because LDAP's not a user authentication system, LDAP's a directory store. It's hard to get logs that say user Bob just authenticated. You tend to get system such and such made this query, and it's like, you know, select users Bob and so forth and attributes. So you get like a long query of stuff instead of a useful single log statement. But I mean, that is tweakable. You can tweak it around, read the data and process in different ways.
So what you're saying is it's not really such an effective tool for auditing user access to?
You'd have to either load some modules or some external apps to simplify the information you're getting and use it in a useful way. We tend to do it by pulling the information, the logs out, and just filtering them to what we actually care about.
Yeah.
But it's not like, you know, var log secure, we can actually see, this is a new VM. Like, you know, var log secure, we can actually see, you know, user tried doing such and such or whatever. It's not that verbose.
Yeah.
Cool, so we've got LDAP running. Should have path to find. Yep, I've got that. Yum install. Okay. So I've installed the client's package which provides tools for managing open LDAP on the command line. So LDAP search, cool. So if you come from a SQL background, you do queries and statements and you do a SQL select to get information out. Open LDAP works on a search basis. We define a search term or an attribute match you want to find for and it queries information out. So if I do simple authentication, currently there's nothing in the database so it won't return anything. But you see up here, it's doing a filter, basically saying, give me any object class. So there's data in there, you'll get every single thing possible. In my case, there's no data, you don't get anything. So let's add some data. Now, depending on your systems, I'll just remove that junk. Depending on your systems, if you're using a management tool, you might just report a management tool at it, and it'll just do all the setup and create some structure for you automatically. If you like paying, you'll do it all manually from command line. And if you're using my tool, I tend to load a seed file in, it's got a basic view that's already created, and you go from there. So depending on what you're doing, sorry, skip this. In my case, I'm going to grab a seed file. Let's just download this.
I'm going to do it by hand, not
using magic, and just show you a bit how it works. So, sample seed. This is a seed file for a basic LDAP directory. So, we've got to find our base organization units, DC example, DC com. It's defined in LDAP itself, but we're going to find it here as well. Defining our organizational units underneath that. So, in this case, OU auth, operational unit is authentication, DC example, DC com. And then we're defining a structure of that, people and groups. Really annoying one. Some LDAP servers by default use OU equals group. Some use ODAP equals groups, plural. I've, at least in the case when I last tried it, Red Hat directory server likes to use groups, and OpenLDAP likes to use group. Real pain in the ass if you're ever moving between between LDAP servers and you're not familiar with that, it'll cause a few headaches. It's not unsolvable, you just got to make sure your configuration knows it's plural or singular, but it's annoying. Zones, I'll talk about that a bit later on. Zones are a structure I've put in place, it's not a mandatory LDAP feature. And a basic user, so this is real world simple stuff. It's basically UID, common name, and the ID numbers, as well as the basic classes, account, POSIX account, shadow account, their shell, their home directory, and we've got to set them a password, which we haven't done yet. Setup user, so in Linux, every user has a group that matches their name. Group user Jethro is a group called Jethro. You don't have to be a member of it, you just have to define it. And by default, I create a few handy groups that are useful off the shelf. But again, these are all optional depending on the structure that you're using. In the case of the tool I've written, these are quite handy to make life a bit easier. So we need a step password again. Do we still have it? No, we don't. Step password. Cool. So I've generated a hashed password. Place this. Sweet, save the time. Done, save. Okay, so we've got an LDIF file. LDIF is basically a text file that defines some radius data. It's probably a more technical explanation for it, but that's typically what it does. So you've got different commands. You've got LDAP, add, delete, modify, and of course search. So pretty straightforward. LDAP add will import an LDAP file and whatever's in it. LDAP delete will delete specific records. If you're deleting stuff, you just need to know the DN, which is like UID equals Jethro, or DC example, DC com. And if you're doing a modification, you have to state what record to match, like DN to match, and what record to replace and what to set it to. You don't really want to be doing this via command line. If you have to, for some reason, it's useful to know, but typically, use a tool, make your life easier. Cool, so LDAP add. I want to find simple authentication, and the file will be... Now this should fail. Yeah. Strong authentication required. So remember earlier when we looked at the permissions in... So, the authenticated user can write themselves, a user can read, and anonymous systems can authenticate. Of course, we're anonymous at the moment, we're trying to authenticate and it's refusing us because we're trying to write to stuff. So we need to define who we're logging on as. There's some config files, like, you know, preference files you can save a lot of your settings into. So on your server, once you set it up, you want to save what your default username is, what your password is, and so forth. But you can do it all via the command line as well. So we're basically saying, here is my root user or the manager of a directory. And use W basically says, ask me for a password because you again need one.
Okay, so you'd find something in localbox, you're trying to
ping
a remote host and then authenticating as the CM.
Yeah, but even your localbox you have to authenticate. It's very much like, you know, a MySQL database. You have to authenticate as the user, even though it's local.
Yeah.
It's still a client-server approach. And there's different ways you can do authentication, like other backends you can use for it, but this is just real simple authentication stuff at the moment. So it's going, okay, what's your manager password? Password, done. Ooh, that broke. Why did that break? That broke because I'm an idiot and I've got a bad sample file. So server's unwilling to perform, no global superior knowledge. That's a really helpful message that basically means you didn't define this structure here, so I can't add this structure here. That's the annoyance with the command line management of LDAP. The error messages aren't great if you're a new user. Instead of just saying, you know, you should have defined DC example, DC amber, DMS, DMS.com, it just says it doesn't fucking work.
Wait, didn't you already?
Nah, so if I show you the file, this is my fault. So I'm using DC examples.com, and whoops, someone left a typo in a seed file, which is DC amber, DMS, my company. I don't actually want that. That's my mistake. So I'll correct that. And just face it, first few times you use LDAP, you're gonna make a lot of mistakes if you're doing a manual import from the beginning.
Yeah.
If you're using a tool, hopefully it makes your life a bit easier. Then again, based on the quality of some of the tools, they might make your life harder.
So it doesn't have inheritance in that sense that you have to specify.
Yeah, it's like trying to make do, you know, like /temp/apple/foo,
There's a switch though for
pineapples. You know, that's going to fail because the parents don't exist. Whereas make do, you know, you do a P, create everything you want.
Yeah.
There's no equivalent to that. Well, I don't believe there's equivalent to that with LDAP add. So we're creating that file now. It's set up correctly, so let's do an import again.
What is going to do? Will
it
fail? It
will fail now because
it already,
exists. Mm-hmm. So you have to define a behavior by fev continue, which is slash C. Already exists, now adding the new entries, and yep, happy.
Okay,
sure. Now let's do an LDAP search. X is basically the same basic authentication versus some more advanced options. That did not work very happily.
You haven't defined the base.
LDAPs
is just another client tool, so you search against the default server and it automatically use US authenticating against
the server. Yeah, so X is simple authentication rather than SSL or some other method. You can also use options like --z to force SSL, like failed with no SSL in place.
Minus B.
Cool. Oh, yeah, Jim Watson did that. Cool. B.
Sorry,
I'll consult Glenn. Yes. Is there another one I've done?
In your searches, does it pick up on regex? Can you do wildcard?
Kind of, you do a
particular format you can use to.
Oops, it doesn't work well.
-s sub.
Yeah, I was looking at the syntax for my other boxes. Nah, just check by my other boxes. I moved
to this box of
Debian, network manager keeps clobbering my search domain. I can't find a way to set it globally. I haven't looked, I did it on Fedora, okay, but I've been lazy and haven't looked yet. Oh, I don't know why it's working on that one. Okay, I'm just...
Fine.
Yeah, that's fine. Twisting. That's just a note. So if you define it in the global config, so you can define it at your default settings.
How much traffic does LDAP actually generate?
Depends what's talking to it. Like, I've seen some badly written programs, it's online, which will send it a request per page load, because you're authenticating every time, and there's some other good software will authenticate once for a session, and you've got, you know, one connection, and that's it. A Linux server will send semi-frequent packets, depending on what caching's in place.
So caching is a standard feature of the...
Depends on the distribution and the version. Like, I know with Fedora, more recent version of Fedora, they moved to a cached model where they run a daemon called triple SD, and that basically caches all your user database. They're not querying it from the server every single time.
You don't have to hit the thing for every trivial little...
Whereas, by default, Linux will send quite a few requests this way. They're not big requests, and they're quite speedy, but it does send them towards it.
If you're going to have a Linux server, you really want to make sure you've got NSS switch and appropriate libs caching set up.
Triple SD is a lot nicer in respect of works better for offline devices. So, from my understanding, I haven't played much with it. From my understanding, Triple SD on this laptop, I can pretty much pick my laptop, walk out the door, and still authenticate based on the locally cached information.
Yeah, that was my other question.
It's a nice way of doing it.
Yeah, so you don't need much maybe sub all?
It might be. It's been a while since I've done it. Look, one more command.
No, sorry. Get rid of the word sub, say
all. Yeah. Right. Sorry, guys, it's been a while since I had to do a manual search query. Base one sub children. So it's already doing a search based on all values.
I'm wondering if you got the B in the wrong one.
So I've got check. This is LDAP.com. We're doing a search for all object classes. Question all. Hang on. We are thinking it's right object server, right? I've done wrong.
You haven't been
second pressing
enough
good,
so the demo
blocks. Yeah. It's always the simplest thing that goes wrong, eh? Main page. Space trigger. Where'd you find that?
Just try authenticating.
Yeah, I did find it that moment ago. Oh, I didn't, okay. Dash D, sorry. Dash D, DC equals example, DC equals com, dash W. Ah, okay. My ACLs must be wrong. So I authenticated this manager and I got the full data dump out of the thing. So trying to do a search as the local user, as a nobody, nothing. Doing a search as the admin. Actually, I pop into this. So as the admin, it's giving me a full dump out of a directory of what's actually in there. So obviously my permissions are wrong. It's not allowing, well actually they're probably good. It's not allowing any old user to dump the database out. So that's what's wrong there. Whereas I suspect on my devel server, I've probably got, yeah, on my devel server I've got an LDAP RC file, which basically says bind as the manager user. So always run as basically, you know, root. Because, you know, when you're doing this frequently, you don't keep doing
it. Is this because your search criteria that you're doing included basically
users' password attributes? Possibly. Although normally just excludes that record. I'll check the ACL in a minute. It's probably what's probably wrong. So we've done that now. It's dumped out all the information, and you see the user passwords are in a hashed form.
Is that a good thing?
Yeah, that's a good thing. So you know, you can't just, if you got all in plain text, it would be a bad thing.
No, but it actually flushes the password for instance, to begin with. I mean,
So it stores it in that form. You will occasionally come across an LDAP server which does use plain text. Before you badmouth it and the admin has been an idiot, it sometimes is for a reason. There's a few RADIUS environments that require the password to be stored in a plain text format in order to be encoded in a certain way and sent to the RADIUS server, RADIUS devices. The last time I played around with that was with some PAP authentication or some microticks. It's uncommon, but you do have to do it occasionally.
Double colon,
that's a good question. I think it's to do with the formatting of the hashed passwords, like saying this is an encoded format. But, good question, I'm not entirely sure. Cool. So we've done a dump, we know that a database is in there, that's all good. Now let's have a quick look at that configuration. Access to Astro, south, right, users, read, anonymous, off. How do I do it on my defaults? Good point. Anonymous can authenticate, but they can't read the database. Yeah. So if we change that to read.
Did he read and off?
No, read should include off. Yeah, read will include off. That'd be fine. Now we can do LDAP search without all that stuff, and now we've got records. Okay. This isn't ideal at the moment. This config's kind of bad because it's giving us the hashed password without. This, with this user being completely untrusted. This is just a random box on the network, and I've dumped the full directory, including the hashed password. Now, hashed password doesn't mean you can log on, but once you've got the hashed password, you can try and start brute forcing it. It's like, on a Linux box, you've got etc password, which is, you know, readable. If you look into it, you can see, oh yeah, here are my users, but your shadow directory, shadow file, is root only, and if you cat that, it's all hashed. Well, not this case, it's not my users. There we are. So it's a hash password, but it's still restricted because having the hash gives you a much easier thing to try and attack rather than guessing every single password under the sun. Cool. So we want to actually fix those permissions a little bit more.
So if you want to build in additional mitigators like, bumping users off at 3 attempts, two-factor authentication.
Yeah, some modules for bumping stuff off after a certain amount of denials and so forth.
Yeah.
You can do all that.
So that's something you would look at an LDAP.
There's a module middle. For it in our open LDAP. Yeah, if you need to documentate, look up docs on that one and
file
use it accordingly.
File to ban or something like that.
So what I'm doing here is I'm saying access to this attribute, let's delete the line altogether, access to attribute user password. So if a user's logged on by themselves, they can write it. If it's an anonymous authentication attempt, you can authenticate it. If it's an anonymous server, you can authenticate against that field. So the server can send it a hash password and confirm that it matches. And by anyone else, you can't do anything. So if we go back and do our query, this time you notice there's no passwords being returned. It's just the actual general information. So
is auth.
Well, the password's hidden because you can only auth it.
That's
you can authenticate it, but you can't read it. Yeah. Which is a much better way of doing
it
because you're not seeing
reading,
the hashes.
What
I'm doing is, so I'm reading the rest of the database. You are anonymous read, no worries. But I'm not myself, so I can't. I'm not myself, so I can't write the user. I'm anonymous, so I can authenticate it, but I can't read it. But everyone else, no access.
Access to attributes password.
So it proceeds in order.
Restrict access per attribute.
Yeah.
If you had another attribute you didn't want people to read, you could block that one.
And you can overload previous settings with subsequent.
Yeah, I think it's in order of execution, yeah. So and your default is, in this case, learn to read it, but not much else. Anyone else? So at the moment if you're logged on as user, you can write your password, you can authenticate anonymously, if you're anyone else, you can't do anything with that field, and everyone else can read the database, but not that one field. Cool. So that's running. We've got an LDAP server going. Next step is you actually want to do something with it. So what we want to do next is make it so our local server is talking to LDAP for its user information so we can actually log on as an LDAP user. So on Linux you've got...
By the way, how are you going to... You've got to say 20, you can probably go to 4 apart
from
20 online if you want, but...
I mean, giving
you an update on.
I'm here till whenever. You've
got about an hour.
So yeah, that's cool, we're done. You guys will be bored by then. Cool, so this really is a bit annoying. Every distribution has its own set of tools to manage PAM configuration and NSS configuration. So on Linux you've got two main systems. One is NSS, that provides the name information. So what the user's name is, what their group information is, all the details of the user. And you've got PAM, which handles authentication. What process the user has to go through in order to validate their credentials. So NSSwitch.conf defines where you go to resolve information like a password lookup or a user lookup. In this case, you know, user lookups look in the files area, which is on disk, etc password, shadow, use etc shadow, group, use etc group, very standard stuff. But you can define other sources, for example, DNS-based information, database information, LDAP, NIS, other forms of information. And you've got PAM, which is etc, ls, etc, PAM.d. PAM rules define for a particular program what rules to follow to authenticate a user. So it's PAM.d. For most users, it's, where we are?
System auth,
here we are. So for most users, it goes, okay, you can have things, for example, brute force protection, limits on logons, or it depends on how you want to proceed. Now, PAM's not really the most user-friendly configuration to ever deal with manually. So most distributions have a tool to make it a lot easier. I think the last time I ever fucked around a PAM manually was when I was writing a distribution. Any other time, look up your tools and use them. It'll make your life a lot easier. And Red Hat has a lovely one called AuthConfig.
By the way, just for note to that, there's a really neat tool called PAM testing.
Okay.
That allows you to test any of those types, and it's not installed. It's not
real. Yeah.
But I highly recommend it if you're ever working with PAM.
Yeah. The nice thing about PAM is if you break your settings, you won't be able to log on. And I mean, you won't be able to log on. You won't be able to log on as any user, root, anything. You break login entirely. You just hit a box down and go to run level 1 to fix it. So yeah, be careful.
If you break your settings in another way, everyone will be able to log on with no password.
Yeah.
Any password.
That's also quite bad. Can't do that. So it's quite tends to be a bit easier using your distro tool. Red Hat's got one called AuthConfig. Which is a GUI or TUI, like, you know, a CLI-based tool. And actually, we're just cancelling out there. Red Hat also allows you to do it on a scripted basis, so you can actually define all the settings you want to do on the command line, which is handy when you're doing large deployments. You can just push out one command to your servers and have it define everything you ever want.
You run the GUI tool, don't you?
But I'm going to run the GUI tool, because, you know, I'm a horrible, horrible noob who's going to use the GUI, because it's easy. So, two sides to it. I want to use LDAP for the user information, the username, the shell information, all that sort of stuff. And I wish to use LDAP for the actual credential authentication, validating their password. The interesting thing with Linux is you can use different systems. So I could use potentially LDAP for the user info, but then use Kerberos for the password credential authentication, because Kerberos provides single sign-on, but it doesn't provide user details, which is what LDAP does. So you can mix and match to some degree to create the solution you need. Okay, yep, that's good. Next. Okay, there are some basic features for configuring the LDAP. Oh, we can actually leave that, but oh well.
You need signed certs to do TLS.
Yeah, to do TLS, you have to do signed certs, and I'll give you a little, I'll show you where to go to get docs for that. It's a bit of a pain because you've got to install the CA for your server in a certain directory on OpenLDAP, so it knows where to go look at. It has to be in a certain file name format as well. You can't just shove it in the directory and have it find it. You'll give it a certain name. And it's a little trick to that I'll show. And basically, what's your search path? If you've got a large organization with, say, 100 different trees, you're not going to want to leave it on the very root, because then it's going to search every single record to find a user. You might say, actually, you should be looking in OU equals Auckland, OU equals Evil Corp, just to narrow it down so you don't waste so much time searching the whole thing. In our case, we can just say OU equals auth, and that'll cover everything. Cool. Now, if you look at, as you see, ldap.conf, that's gone and written some of the settings in here for us. But basically, define what the base directory is. There's a whole bunch of timeout options you can tweak. There's a whole bunch you don't need in here in relation to like different types of LDAP servers or even Active Directory servers. And we've defined, you know, what's our server, no SSL, we don't care about that, and also the format of the passwords. Now, if we do, the command of Linux is called getent. So, with LDAP, well, tend to be if you're in sysadmin on Linux, you go, oh, who's on the system? Okay, etc password. Okay, those users are configured on the system. Of course, with LDAP, you're not going to be defined in the password directory. So the call called getent. You should use getent anyway, but it's a very bad habit, and everyone always does etc password, particularly if you've looked after smaller deployments where you're not used to having a central authentication server. But getent is a true system, it gives you an idea of what's actually there. So if I get into password, what users actually are available to the system? And in this case, it's now picked up our LDAP user setup. Whereas if I look at etc password, that user doesn't exist. So getent is the best way to go for everything in regards to this sort of stuff. Because you're a mix of where it's come from. And also you can do the same with group. And we can say, yep, we've got our setup group and we've got an LDAP admins group. Now, although LDAP setup, if I do a user add, it's still going to be a local process. I believe you can actually make it add a user if you tweak it right, but by default it's local. If I do a password change though, it will push it through to LDAP. So this issue is set up. Okay, depending on distribution, some distributions will be handy and generate your home directory by default. Because, of course, if you've got lots of servers and haven't got a central mounted home directory, every server you log onto for the first time, you're going to need to create a home directory for. You can configure PAM to do it automatically for you, and that saves you a lot of headaches. So I've got my home directory, I've logged on setup, and if I try and execute it myself, it's going to ask me for the LDAP password. And yeah, I authenticated. If I did it wrong, going to the usual. So a user trying to get in doesn't see the LDAP on the back end, it's transparent for them. If I do a password change, then you'll notice it's going, actually, I want to change your LDAP password, not your system password. Because there is no system password, it's all LDAP stored. Cool, now I define it. And I'm not going to do that because I've got, you know, password's not bad, not good to use. But the cool thing is, you know, you can still log on, change the password, whatever, and it'll update in LDAP. And if using the right modules, like Ben pointed out, it'll also update like a standard password as well.
So what's really nice here is that one machine is useful.
I mean, yeah, if you're deploying one PC, you're not going to want to use this, it's not worth the hassle. Deploying two, again, probably not worth it. Deploying maybe five machines, it's going to start becoming useful when you've got a lot of churn of users. So for a personal user, for five machines, you have to add yourself, and who cares? But for a company, staff come, staff go. And I've dealt with a number of companies now that have grown organically from small businesses where there's like two staff up to where there's 20. And when you've got 20 staff, you actually get a fair bit of churn. Oh, Bob's left. Okay, we've got to log on to every one of the 30 servers and remove his details. And then log on to all these web applications and remove his details. And you actually spend half a day going around removing a user or adding a new user in. LDAP makes all that pain so much easier.
I can also take experience. Retrofit it, and you've got 30 servers with Bob on, and Bob's got a different UI for each server.
Oh, goodness.
Yeah.
You can't easily retrofit it.
Yeah. Now, that's a real pain. First time you add it to an existing box, obviously you're going to blow away all your old users. And if we've got the same IDs that clashed, what will happen is user Jethro is now an LDAP user, and he's got the ID that once belonged to Bob. So I can now read Bob's files, but not my own. So you have to be careful, either you've got to choose a numbering scheme that doesn't currently clash. For example, your local host might be using, say, 500 plus. If you've got 50 users, you're using 500 to 550, and you might use 1,000 for LDAP. Avoids the issue, then you just got to go through and update the user's files to the correct UID number, which is relatively easy. You just got to do a bit of a process. If you're unlucky, it clashes, then you'll do a whole bunch more work to make sure you're not giving that wrong access to the wrong people. Yeah, I'm not sure what the max is these days. Yeah, I mean, I'm using 1,000 for myself. I'm not sure what the max UID value is, actually. Been a while since I looked it up.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how high you can go. But like I say, if you deploy from the start, it makes your life a lot easier. And if you're working for an organization that's expected to grow its server number or its user number, doing it from the start makes it a lot easier. Because also, once you've got it in place, you then go, okay, we're deploying some new software to our network. Does it authenticate against LDAP? If it does, sweet, done. Or, no, it doesn't, well, we better get that patched and make sure it does before we put it in. Whereas if you're retrofitting it, you'll find that, okay, all my servers support LDAP, no worries, but this one particular web app that was developed by some Hungarians 5 years ago doesn't support LDAP, and now I've got to add it into the code. And it becomes a lot more annoying to do it on a retrospective basis. Particularly once you've got data in that program, because typically web apps, everyone's got their own unique structure for doing user and permissions allocation. So you've got to try and make sure your new LDAP group, new LDAP users align with your old ones and so forth. Speaking from experience, at work we have several web apps that don't support LDAP. And for one of them, I'm Jethro.car. For one, I'm Jethro. And for another, I'm Jethro@prophecy.net.nz. So there's three variations of my username. If I go tomorrow, okay, I'm sick of this, I'm going to steal LDAP modules for all these web apps. My new LDAP user, Jethro, is not going to align with two of those three applications. And I'm going to have to do a whole bunch of pain trying to get it to align. So doing it in advance is a lot easier. Cool. So we've got users set up now. We can log on as them. That's kind of cool, I guess. But we don't really have to do the whole manual process of adding a user from the sample file every single time.
ETC NS switch, by the way.
Oh, yeah, sure. So ETC NS switch, pop to the list. So this file's been updated by Red Hat and LDAP here. So it looks at the local files first and then goes to LDAP. If you're retrofitting an existing server, make sure you clear out the locally defined users. You can get some weirdness if you've got them defined as well. Depending on your system, sometimes it can use the local password as authentication instead of LDAP. Other times you just get two users appearing. Not that great. Let's have a quick example. So if I add, say, setup x100, 100, so here I've now got two users because one's defined locally and one's defined on the LDAP. Generally not a situation you really want. So make sure you do go and remove the old ones from the system. Cool. So that's defined. Now let's load on a management tool because that'll make life a little bit easier for us. Okay, I'm still in my one because I'm going to show off my own tools. Don't break. So in this case, I've packaged my tool into an RPM, and I'm just going to install everything I need out of the repo.
Your own repo or upstream?
This is my own one. It's also open source and publicly available. The application I'm using, LDAP Auth Manager, you can install from source, from SVN, or from RPM, and it only requires basic dependencies on the server already. Mm-hmm. I've got my own repos for newer versions of PHP and so forth, so it's a little different. And of course, you don't have to use this tool. There's tons of other tools you can be using. I mean, Grabmandriva's got its own tool. Red Hat released something called Red Hat, I think IPA. We've tried to package all these tools together into one graphical interface. When I last looked at it was still too immature, but it's probably improved a bit since then.
It's now general release.
General release? Cool.
I highly recommend that if you are building any Red Hat
program. Yeah, so it's definitely improving a bit.
Because it also features a whole bunch of extra stuff that's not just the old.
Yeah. So yeah, like vendors like Red Hat doing a lot of work to make stuff a bit easier to deal with. So
OpenSUSE also has it built in. OpenSUSE server
that
supports built into the
GUI. Yeah.
So
that's quite handy.
It's quite hard to not end up with this.
Cool. So the tool I've got, LDAP Auth Manager, it's pretty simple. Once you've installed it, from whether it's RPM or SVN or whatever, I'm just gonna do an auto install process to set up MySQL. There's no Maybe it helps if I start MySQL. There we are. Of course, you should always secure MySQL, but I'm going to ignore that because I'm lazy at the moment.
Don't need to for a demo.
Cool, because that's installed the database schema, and now we need to adjust the actual LDAP details. This tool is built on a framework that requires MySQL. It's only for the application settings. It doesn't store any use data in there. Cool, so it's already created, I say, LDAP, the MySQL database and password. So LDAP's an interesting bit. Okay, so I've already disabled SSL, using password, manager, dtexamples.com. So all the defaults here actually match our demo install. HTTP restart. Config IP tables. Should probably allow access to the web interface. Test page. It's going to bring a self-signed search, even though I'm being intercepted. Cool. So here's the tool I've got.
Well, this is authenticating using an LDAP.
Yep, so this actually authenticates and gives LDAP. So the seed that we put in before defined the setup user.
Yeah.
And now we're going to log on to them using the right password this time. Yep. So LDAP Auth Manager authenticates using LDAP itself. You're going to want that any tool that you end up using is going to be doing that. It's a smart way of doing so. So this little tool I wrote for a few customers. We've actually got some reasonably large customers using this. Basic stuff is I'm logged on to myself. I can define my own part using that. Real name, surname, and credentials. Like password reset. Or because I'm the admin, I can go and manage user accounts. So this is LDAP done right. Bob. We really love Bob, don't we? Bob Smith. Leave black. Ah, yeah. In the older days, and I'm not sure if it's changed yet, open LDAP and Red Hat Directory Server don't automatically generate a UID value when you add a user account. Because remember, to them, it's just a data record. I know Red Hat released a later update to Red Hat Directory Server that would automatically generate a UID if it realized you were adding a user. But otherwise, the manual process is you have to look at who's currently got an account, which ID is available, use that one, make sure it doesn't clash. I'm not sure, Glenn, do you have any modules for Open LDAP to make it easier? Yeah, from what I believe, OpenLDAP doesn't have any module that will automatically generate a UID or check for UID clashes. So in my case, the GUI tool does it all for me. It looks up, you know, I can leave it blank and it will find me a unique one that isn't used yet and assign it. Or I can put a specific one or say this is available or no, it's not.
Looking for the highest number and adding one to it?
Correct, yeah, it looks for the most available one and it validates that it's actually not already taken in case another tool's being used. At the time. Cool, and password. Password, done. Cool, so now our user groups, yep, set up and Bob. And we can see here it's assigned Bob 1020. If I'm trying to add another user, Bob 2. If I try and use his ID number, because I'm trying to say port across an existing set of users or whatever, it will go, bad idea, it's already in use. So there's a bit of sanity checking in here to make sure you don't fuck your database up too much.
Some other reason that you should be using
a tool of some kind.
Well-defined GUI is that they need validation of
these. Remember, doing it from a manual process is like using PHP MyAdmin or MySQL command line to edit stuff directly. This is using a tool which understands the structure of data and what it's supposed to look like and manages it accordingly. Same thing for groups. So here, by default, this tool hides groups that match that exist only to match users, because you don't really care about the setup group or the bob group. They're only ever going to be just sitting there.
But you can't display them. You create those groups because on LDAP directories that I've seen, those groups don't usually exist.
Yeah, I mean, you don't actually have to do it. I just did that to match for way the conventional Linux boxes work, but you don't have to do it. Does, yeah. Like, you don't have to, I mean, you can have everyone just belonging to a group called users, and it wouldn't really matter. There's no specific reason why. In fact, I was trying to think of a use case where you actually need a group that belongs to a user. I'm trying to think of the case. I can't even think of the case.
There are already cases where you actually did add other users to that group.
Yeah.
So you normally add groups, users to their own group, so it all gets really confusing.
And normally add a group anyway, so, yeah, I mean, you could probably change this and get rid of that.
Yeah. I've just seen in picture if you structures that I've seen, those users tend to belong to the group related to their, users or admins.
Like some of the larger deployments we've deployed for ISPs for storing customer records, we've just done a group which is basically customers, and everyone just belongs to customers to reduce the number of records we're keeping. And you know, you can also add a specific group, users, whatever. Man, okay, set up's a member and Bob's a member, do that sort of basic stuff. The other feature of this tool is it can actually monitor an LDAP server. So if you set up your LDAP server to log using syslog, this program actually has a package you can install on that server that will basically tail the log file and push the logs to the web interface. Because we have a lot of customers who don't know how to touch a command line, but their admins know how to use a GUI. So we say to an admin, here's the log file running on screen, and this log process will actually pretty much real-time Ajax display the logs coming from LDAP. This could be a debugging stuff. Adding an application to LDAP, trying to figure out why it's not working. This can be quite handy. But again, you don't need it for everyone. In fact, we can actually turn that off.
So this all tools just on the basic LAMP stack?
Yeah. Uses MySQL, PHP, where you go. PHP 5, any version will do.
You've got about half an
hour to see. Yeah. So let's go over radio. So, that's LDAP, basically it's a directory for users, and find some tools that you like, makes life a lot easier.
Cool tool, man.
Cheers. And like I didn't say, there's a whole bunch of other tools around for different distributions. Do some research, see what suits you. One reason for this tool is, getting onto the RADIUS subject, RADIUS has a feature called attributes where you can pass out information, like I was saying earlier. For example, customers that didn't have boxes like Cisco's or Juniper's, often you want to pass like a Cisco-specific admin flag, like this user is a admin or this user is a user only, to validate what level of permissions the box should give it, whether you can enable and change your configuration, for example. LDAP allows you to store that in a directory, and we actually added a feature to this tool called RADIUS attributes, which is disabled on this demo. We'll find another one. I'll find you one that's got some data on it. Actually looks a bit better. Okay, so manage users. So this is a developed box I've got running. So in here I can define a whole bunch of attributes that get passed through to a device in RADIUS, including vendor specifics and any custom ones as well. Now if we take a look at the RADIUS server.
And then you can define the objects from your tool as well?
Yes, correct, yeah. So some tools will do that, some won't. In this case, mine does. So we want to install free RADIUS. If you're using a RHEL box, and it's a RHEL 5 box, you've got two options for free RADIUS. You've got free RADIUS 1, which is the default package, which is ancient, or you've got free RADIUS 2, which is an actual version you probably actually want to use.
Backwards compatible?
The config you can port from free RADIUS 1 to 2. It's a change of a program version, not a change of a protocol. It's just that Red Hat ships a really old version by default, because Red Hat 5 is pretty old now.
Yeah.
And when it shipped, they started using free RADIUS 1. Now the rest of the world's moved on to free RADIUS 2, which is better design, newer features, and so forth. But you can still get both. In this case, I'm running the latest version because I built it myself the other day. So I'm just grabbing that. If you're doing a deployment, do go get the latest version of free RADIUS. I found a few bugs in the older versions that shipped by Red Hat that will actually cause you headaches in large deployments. Most users won't notice them, but they do cause occasional problems. Like a nifty little one where free RADIUS seek faults every few hours on the default Red Hat version. So doing a large deployment, wondering why all of a sudden users can't log on for a few minutes every day. Yeah, not the greatest. And ooh, don't lose my network. That's kind of sad. Come on, demigods.
I'll have to.
Oh, there we are, it's delayed, there we are. Something bounced on the network. Cool. So RADIUS is stored in RADDB. Kind of a weird name, but whatever. So, by default, free RADIUS will rely on local authentication. We want to adjust it to use LDAP. Older versions of RADIUS had all this in the radius.conf file. Newer versions use modules, which define additional abilities. Free RADIUS 2, I want to use off. Let's find it. I'm install free RADIUS 2 LDAP. Perhaps install the right packages. There we are. Yes, free RADIUS 2 LDAP installs LDAP module for it. LDAP. So in here basically defining all the settings for LDAP. Again, it's very similar to stuff before. Define what your server is, what your base structure is, so DC examples.com, filters, and so forth.
Now,
just get back to from a second.
Yep.
Just to answer a question, you're asking about search criteria and with LDAP.
Yeah.
That's, for example, a search criteria.
Okay, so it's got its own little syntax.
It's its own format.
Yeah.
Relatively complicated to understand. I'm not
going to
keep up, but it does have
it.
That's an example.
Yeah, I mean, with free RADIUS, we can just search for what's the username or password that matches the query we're doing. I'm going to show you a structure on a newer server.
Sorry, you're authenticating now as, in this case, you would authenticate as the RADIUS service client, not as a regular user.
Correct, yeah.
Okay.
So in this case, I could use a management account or create another account and use that.
The way best would be to
create a new. Depends on your practice. I mean, if you're just running at five boxes, you probably need a management, whereas if you're running a large network, you're going to be locking things down to different users
a
bit more.
Where your compromise is coming from, that sort of thing.
Pretty much, yeah. Now, I don't want to do this all manually, so I'm just going to go to a box. Here's one I prepared earlier. So here's a box I prepared earlier. Well, no, I didn't. What happened there? Ah, this is a really bad example to touch it for. Okay, here's a bad one. I actually just ported this box the other day from 3 radius 1 to 3 radius 2. I'll try and test the problem, but it means I've actually got a bit of an ugly config. But effectively, here's an actual real world example of what it looks like. So here's an actual LDAP server, an actual management user, an actual password. That's only applied to the VUL in case you're wondering about my security and the structure there. So, using no TLS. If you're running both on the same box, there's actually no need to have TLS from RADIUS to LDAP. But if you're running a separate server and you don't trust the connection in between, you're going to want TLS in place. Access attribute, so we're looking for any object that starts with UID, so UID Jethro, UID Bob. Password format. In the old days, you used on 3 radius 1, and a lot of old documentation will say if you set the password header, if you set the attribute, just cheat. Use auto header equals yes, and I'll just handle it. Whether it's plain text, SSH, MD5, whatever.
That's your entity password.
Yeah, so using entity passwords is a different thing again. But in this case, you're always going to have a Unix style password. Entity password might be an available in addition. We're doing a search here on the group membership, so saying do a search for whether the user belongs to the group by looking for the member UID. The reason we're doing this is there's actually different ways to store the association of a user to a group, which is really annoying because you can define it using member UID equals Jethro, or it could be member UID equals Jethro colon DC example.com, the full DN path. And different applications expect different things by default and also support different behaviours.
The other one it can be is inside your group.
Yeah, you can also do the other way, define it on the group itself. So the way I tend to use it is on the group, but you can do it other ways. And
the worst part about this is that there's no way to sync the two together.
Yeah, you're basically fucked. The other annoying one is Linux PAM relies on the full DN, if I remember correctly. Good luck. Yeah, PAM uses a different attribute called unique member, which relies on a path looking something like that. Whereas by default, Unix group, you just got, you know, Jethro or test instead of full bang.
Just out of interest, are they specific in an order, or is it just arbitrary, just throw them in as long as it's everything?
So you're talking about
The C and the OUs and the B's.
They have to be structured in that order. It's flexible. I mean, you can chuck in any number of them. It's not structurally defined. You might be, I've never actually tried putting a DC before it, like DC, OU, DC, then OU, and DC, but the way you define it normally is DC at the top, and then your organizational groups, and then your actual records underneath. Feel free to try and break it in some interesting ways.
But they are like, it is a tree structure.
Yeah.
So that tells it how to go.
How to traverse the tree.
Yeah. I'm not sure, if you're trying to do it some dodgy way, I'm not sure if it'll accept it or whether it'll refuse.
One of the points to get back to is it's not a relational database. This is a tree database, and it works based on primary tree search effectively. So, lookups are very, very, very fast, even if you've got a huge number of records.
Okay. Yeah.
Some of the other things you might want to do are not fast. Like, it just depends on the task you're going to do.
For the purpose of authentication, though, it's damn fast. If you get into it and really involved, you can actually tweak what indexes you want, what attributes you want to index, and certain attributes about the database and things like that, like how much memory to allocate the DB, and so much of a tweaking you can do, but if you're doing a smaller deployment, like, you know, under 1,000 users, you don't need to touch any of that to begin with. So yeah, PAM's got a whole bunch. Like, you can actually say, you were saying earlier, you know, how can you lock down so only certain users can log in a certain server? Basically, here's how you do it. You can define group to enforce membership of users must belong to this group in order to log onto this server. I mean, that's pretty common stuff. You don't necessarily want to give everyone access to all servers. You go through and lock that down. Go back to Radius. So Radius, we've defined in radius.conf, we've got the LDAP settings, and we've also defined a few things. Authorize, and I think other ones. Authorize defined as, yeah, we can use files, we can use LDAP, and also for another section, which is authenticate. We define it, we can authenticate using LDAP. Which basically tells free radius, when a user pass comes in, check the local box, check the local host, whatever, check LDAP. We've then got cat ATRs. I made one. Makes life a bit easier. Right. I'll show you in a minute. I couldn't find one off the shelf that I particularly liked. There's probably a whole bunch of other ones as well. The reason I made one is it tied in perfectly with the LDAP tool that we built. And I'll give you a quick demo of that. So this file here, LDAP.ATRMap, allows you to map entries in the LDAP directory with radius attributes. So you don't normally need a touch list, but if you're doing like a vendor box, which often you are dealing with devices, for example, here's a MicroTik one. This is a non-standard configuration. I've defined the attribute MicroTik wireless forwards in LDAP matches that attribute name in radius. So radius knows how to handle it.
Okay. So this is where your device is going to go, I'm expecting this attribute.
Mm.
I'm going to set this attribute, and that attribute doesn't
matter. Radius has got two types of attributes. You've got attributes that you check attributes and attributes and then reply attributes. The check one is, when you authenticate, you should send this attribute along with your authentication request. And reply attribute is, congrats, you've been authenticated, here's some information you're going to want to know, like your IP address or your access permissions on that type of box. Now, with LDAP, it took fucking ages to work out, it's not really well documented. The users file, you can define, instead of defining, because you're using LDAP for your users, you want to define which group, which hunt group belongs to which LDAP group. So I've got like an LDAP group called test group, and I've defined
what's
that.
A hunt group?
A hunt group is when you look at the client configuration. So here we've got client localhost, secret testing 1234. So when the box authenticates on get 127.0.0.1, the radius device, so the router itself, uses these passwords. That's the credentials for the router itself. That then gets looked against hunt groups. And hunt group says, okay, test group. So the device of IP 127.0.0.1, so the local host NAT device, users must come from a test group account. And then the user's file defines the test group account, or test group, matches to list LDAP group. So in the case of if I want to authenticate the local NAS, I have to use the test group in LDAP. It's a little convoluted. I'll give you a quick example.
This is about like authenticating using a serial cable.
Yeah, so here's a radius test command. So for this test, I'm going to use the username test, password test 123, and I'm going to pretend that the network device is the local host, and the password for the network device is testing 1234. And yep, I got permitted, I authenticated. And then the following information got sent back out of LDAP via free radius. Whereas if I was trying to test with a different device, in this case one that doesn't exist, it's going to resend and eventually time out and fail.
And you would use radius to lock down MAC addresses. So you can say you can use radius in conjunction with LDAP to specify which MAC addresses are allowed onto the network?
Well, it depends what device you're talking to. Radius provides authentication, accounting, and information. It's up to the network device how it is used. So your network device might allow you to, say, restrict by MAC, restrict by IP, or...
Yeah, but surely, I mean, your access point would receive the request from your wireless device saying, okay, MAC address XYZ is trying to authenticate. It would send the request through to radio service. Radio service would then do the lockup on LDAP and say yay or nay. And somewhere between
they can do that. But it depends on the infrastructure in place between it. Because LDAP, so radios itself, just provides the tool for sending the information and bringing the information back. It's up to your router or your wireless access point to define how that information is used.
I thought the LDAP would define that.
LDAP is a store of information.
Okay.
Through radius is basically a gateway to the information, and then your router or your network device uses the information in certain ways. So
you could make your, if the router's seen in the MAC address, surely you can make the LDAP search include the data.
Yes, you can include information. But it just goes, yes, that information exists or no, it doesn't. It doesn't do anything smart with it. So in that situation, that example, you'd have your wireless access point that gets the device connected to it and goes, okay, I've got the MAC address, send it to my radio server as its credentials, then looks up and gets the LDAP database, and the LDAP database has got the MAC address, so it gives it access and everything's happy.
Yeah.
But LDAP and free radio is basically just gateways and stores information.
They're not
aware of the significance of the information. They just know to check, does this record exist, or they've authenticated, give them these records. So they're pretty dumb devices. Like if you've got a Cisco router and you use FreeRadius to authenticate it, FreeRadius can send back an admin level permissions value. It doesn't understand what it is, it just to it's a string of text, but it knows how to send it back. And if a Cisco device knows how to use that information to validate the user or give them permissions. It's effectively a gateway. It's a lot to get in. There's a lot to this. So I'll quickly show a tool I built, because it made FreeRadius a little easier. There's probably some other tools around for this, but when we last looked, they weren't great. We've got this been used by a couple of people now.
I've played with FreeRadius on the DDWLT, and it has a FreeRadius client, and you basically hook it up to FreeRadius server that does the whole thing. And, you know, APs generally are pretty dumb devices.
I think they're dumb. I mean, in this case, we use most of these tools to support networks with large numbers of routers in the network. We're talking about hundreds of routers and providing a tool to manage the configuration of FreeRadius for that. So this tool, PHP FreeRadius, is open source, but it's not actually on my repo as a public project yet, simply because I haven't pushed all the documentation up. I'm trying to get onto it one of these near weekends to finish the docs and then release it officially. So I'll try and get it done, then I'll email out to the list, because when you combine this with an LDAP server, you can basically define what your radius server is and what all your NAS devices are, and it will actually write your FreeRadius configuration for you with the knowledge of LDAP. So in here, I can configure configure a NAS device. I can say, it's the test NAS. And its IP is 127.0.0.1. And it's a other device. And you can define what the password is for the device. So in the setups I've done, we've had the passwords for the NAS devices themselves saved in FreeRadius as configuration, but the passwords for the user and the user information is from LDAP.
Mm.
It might be possible to actually store the NASs themselves in LDAP as well. I haven't played around with that, but it is potentially possible. Because remember, LDAP's more than just users and groups. You can also use LDAP to store things like auto mounts for Linux, so that when the user logs on, it queries LDAP to give a list of all the auto mounts it should have, like network shares, and then it will go through and execute and mount all those network shares. So once you actually start looking into what you can do with it, there's a lot more than just authentication, and a lot of stuff that will tie in with authentication to make it do other things.
Cool, man.
So I don't know if I won't go into too much detail now, because I'll be here all night otherwise.
So does Radius not storing any attributes?
Radius doesn't store any attributes. You can use it that way. I mean, you can run FreeRadius completely independently of LDAP, but there's no point doing that unless you just want to authenticate network devices.
So if it's storing attributes, does it store them in its own database?
Yeah, I'm not sure. I've looked it up. I've never actually done it that way. I've always used a backing database, whether it's SQL or LDAP, because, I mean, it makes it much easier to manage. And to be honest, if you're deploying free radius, you probably should deploy LDAP at the same time, because it means you've covered pretty much everything you're ever going to use. If a program doesn't support radius, it's going to support LDAP, or vice versa. With these two combined, you'll support pretty much everything.
Much more to go right now?
No, we'll wrap up there. Hope there's enough to get you guys sufficiently confused and maybe interested.
So it's, I was just going to say, it's 5:09. We don't have to finish
an
Africa course
today,
but if you want to finish.
Well, I'll wrap up anyway, because I can't go into too much detail without going into a lot of detail. So if you want to play around with stuff, the best thing to do is just look at doing LDAP first. Don't worry about radius. Get an LDAP server running. Get your local host authenticating against LDAP. And then look at adding your network devices and doing TLS configuration. It's because of the learning curve involved, it's better off you do a LDAP server with no TLS, no SSL, get it working for local authentication, then add SSL, get that working locally, and then start adding more hosts onto it. Don't shortcut, don't go, SSL's annoying, I'll leave that. It's definitely worth doing from a security point of view, investing your time and making it work. Even though if you haven't done CAs before, it's a little bit annoying. It's worth learning and it's worth building. And once you've got LDAP running, then you can figure out what else you want to add into it. If you want to add radius for your network devices or Samba for your Windows boxes and whatever's appropriate from that. There's a whole bunch of different graphical tools, as we mentioned. My one, I'd recommend it because, of course, it's mine. It's perfect. But there's a whole bunch of other tools around, so do your research, find what's appropriate for your needs. Like I say, if you're using certain distributions, the tools that make it a lot easier.
Tell you why everyone should use yours. So if I write on the open mailing list, you might even notice.
Because it's exactly. Jeffrey, it doesn't work. Ooh, is that fault of mine? Shame, we've got to fix it. So we're using this in some reasonably large deployments. We've got a couple of telco customers in New Zealand using the software to manage their users. One of them using it to manage all their internal admins for all their devices, and another one's using it to manage all their customer records. It seems to work reasonably well. I've done a few hooks into that. The nice thing about using LDAP for this is, like I said before, it's supported by everything. So we've got customers who have like .NET developers writing customer management tools that write into LDAP, and then my tool, or Linux servers, which are using LDAP to authenticate the actual customers in the back end. So there's a really good common ground that most languages and most operating systems can support. Solaris, you can pretty much point straight at LDAP and it'll just work. Any Linux world, probably other Unixes, if you've got any others lying around, should support it as well. It's pretty flexible. macOS, I believe you can use LDAP. macOS server actually has an LDAP server in it. I don't know what it's based on. I'm presuming it's probably an open LDAP derived, but I'm not entirely sure.
Special,
yeah.
So you can use LDAP to deploy policy in Linux world, basically? POSIX world?
Depends what information you're trying to push, but you can certainly push some amounts of detail. Like you can define what you can and can't access, like whether you can or can't log into the server. Mm. You can define all your groups. And of course, once you've got groups defined, you can do all your normal Linux permissions. You can push out things such as your auto FS mounts.
Yeah.
And there's probably a few other things you can push out as well.
To answer that, also, IPA stands is P in that is policy. The current tools that you sort of before IPA do not give you the same policies around what applications a user can run or very strict policies like you would expect from Windows or what things are installed. But people are working on implementing that.
Because that's one of the things that I had a look at. There's a paper called the DSD Top 35, released by the Australian Signal Directive or something like that, which deals with 35 like really good mitigating steps and stuff, like common sense stuff. And one of it is like using policy control to do like whitelisting of applications and processes. And Windows it seems to be fairly trivial matter, but in Linux
Linux doesn't have quite a policy that says users can't change the desktop background, all that sort of stuff. But various people including Red Hat and SUSE are working on implementing or have implemented various bits of it. And the end LDAP can store an attribute that says policies this. It's that
you're
having
totally understand
the client read that attribute and then do something to enforce it. Obviously, you can write your own scripts that will do apparent what. Yeah. It's trivial to read an attribute. Or you can take an existing commercial product.
Yeah. Had a look at App Armor and it's for.
What I want to quickly mention is Kerberos. So if you heard of Kerberos before, it's basically a credential store only. It doesn't support you to store like user details like LDAP does. You combine LDAP and Kerberos, and what Kerberos adds is single sign-on. So I can log into my box, and then from that box, SSH to another one, and it will transparently log me onto that one by passing a token. So you log on once for your session, and you can jump between hosts without logging on every single time. So it's worth checking out if you've got a large network, because...
It also has lots of encryption and complexity.
Oh, it has a lot more complexity to it. If you've heard of it, that's what it does. And it's not actually, it's not a replacement for LDAP, it's an addition that works alongside LDAP. Cool, so I'll email onto the list some details, some links and so forth, to get anyone started or take a look. I've got a lot of docs on my project website for LDAP Auth Manager and how to set up Open LDAP with this particular tool. So if you want to play around, that might be a good place to start. The Open LDAP manual is pretty good. Or grab something like, I haven't played with it myself, because last time I saw it was still in beta. Play around with something like Red Hat IPA or one of the other distribution packages and see how well they work. Mm. Anything that makes it easier is going to be a good deal, so I'm interested in playing with IPA actually.
Good stuff.
Awesome. If you have a question.
I might get myself or Steve or someone to do a quick IPA presentation.
So at some point, switch. Yeah, yeah. Red Hat IPA is obviously the commercial version. Did they have an open branch?
Yes.
I did, yeah.
Free
IPA. Yeah. Ah, yeah, cool.
Which I know currently, one of our customers currently free IPA is switching to IPA.
Oh, yeah.
But it's only because they need to switch the official support, not the free IPA is not working.
Right, yeah. Yeah, I mean, last time I looked at the Red Hat IPA stuff was a couple of years back and it was still very new. It's obviously evolved a lot since then.
It still has some limitations.
Yeah.
Its GUI is really based only on authenticating and dealing with Linux.
Yep.
Service rather than a general directory. It also is designed that it will sync with AD, so you can pull you. So it'll pull users out of AD, put them into this, and then allow a Unix sysadmin to add extra attributes for Linux, etc.
Oh, that's nice.
And yet sync their passes backwards and forwards.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's cool stuff.
Thank you. I think we need to.
No worries, yeah,
awesome.
It's confused enough.
Yeah, pretty awesome technical presentation.
Yeah.
A bit of a speed run. I can miss heaps of stuff, so I'll send some links out. And if you're interested, feel free to fire back questions and say, how do I do this? There's so much more to RADIUS that I haven't even touched on yet, so...